folks. Normally, I would say, hold the applause till the end because I haven't earned it yet, but I'll take it down as an advance payment. So now if I blow it, at least I'm not, you know, totally out of the water. I am Michael Eckers. I was born and raised in Minnesota. And 4 years ago, my wife, who I'd like to introduce in the back, Diane, my navigator, love of my life, and all around, I call her my honey pumpkin lover. And she thought for years that I had made up that term, and then we listened to a Steve Miller song called Dance, 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 and he refers to his honey pumpkin lover, and she looked at me and went, I thought you... So, you know, somewhere subliminal, I guess, in my high school days or something, I must have listened to Steve Miller and picked that up. But we have been traveling for the last 4 years. We sold our home in southern Minnesota. We can do that because we have our health, we're retired, our parents are gone, and we're at a stage in life where our kids are pretty much on their own. And right now we have one grandchild who resides in Ellsworth, Iowa, just over by Ames and Jewell and over there. That is the center of the universe for us. And those of you who have grandkids understand fully what I'm talking about. Little Phoebe is 4.5 years old and a handful and has me right here. So, as she should. But 2 years ago, I wrote a book about five young men from Iowa based on five real guys. They were the, and this is, I have to take a breath because it's a long title. They were the 1941 Iowa State High School basketball champions. Whew, that's a lot. They were from Mason City originally. I moved them to Ames because I'm more familiar with that part of the state. Okay, it's flat and you can get to know it real quick. But in 1941, when the five of them won the championship, it was kind of like the story Hoosiers, where it was a smaller school and they beat one of the bigger city or bigger Des Moines schools for the state title. And then one of them becomes a writer at a small New York paper. So he moves out of the area, goes to the East Coast, gets a job. And 8 months later, World War II breaks out. And his editor, remembering that he was from out west somewhere, as he says it, like Iowa or something, he said, the first US troops are getting ready to go to England. This is a month after World War II begins. And I'm gonna have you go, one, because you're single, and two, you speak the same language as the guys on the ship. Because it was the 34th Division, the Red Bulls. The Iowa and Minnesota National Guard were the first troops, like they were in World War I, they were the first troops to go over in World War II. Well, halfway across the Atlantic, he runs into a teammate. One of the guys who was on the basketball team with him is in the 34th Division, and he finds out that there are other three teammates. One's a Marine, one's a sailor, and one's in the Army Air Corps. So they're all over the world as the war develops. And he writes his editor and explains the situation, and the editor goes, well, go find them. So this 19-year-old kid has to travel around the world as a non-combatant war correspondent finding his teammates. And it's a good story. It is a good story. All of the history in it is true. I just change names of people and give them things to say, which has to be historical fiction because I wasn't even born until 10 years after World War II had ended. So that's Five for Freedom, my newest work. I also am working on a series of books that I call the Colors series. My great-great-grandfather, who was originally from Garwin in Tama County, Gladbrook, Garwin. His last name was Conant, and so I'm one of the Conants from Gladbrook. I don't know what that means, but some people go, oh, when I say that in Iowa. I'm from Minnesota where everybody goes, Conant, what's that? Anyway, so I wrote a book about him and his adventures in the American Civil War, and he was a color bearer for a regiment where the life expectancy was 30 seconds. 30 seconds for a color bearer. You were the prime target on the field because flags were important back then. They did more than just tell you who was who. They told you where you were going and everything else. And he survived. He was in that job for 1.5 years. So he defied the odds big time. And then I wrote about my grandfather who was in the 34th Division at the beginning of World War I. He was one of the first doughboys to go to France. And he was used to train Marines how to fight Germans in trenches in France. His son is my father. This is my mom and dad. That's their picture, their wedding photo from World War II. My dad was a bombardier in the 8th Air Force. He flew 11 missions and then was shot down and spent 9 months as a prisoner of war in Germany. So he had adventures, while my mom had adventures here on the home front. And the story goes on. I have a son, our youngest son today is a lieutenant in the Navy, in the submarine service, the silent service, so I'm afraid I can't tell you what he does because he would have to kill you. I don't kill people. I've been out of the military for a long time. but I also write stories about other people. Down in the lower right corner, Wisconsin Iron, is about Henry McCollum, very real young man from the center of Wisconsin. When the war, Civil War broke out, he was 16 years old and got permission from his parents to join the 2nd Wisconsin Infantry because his uncle Archibald was in the unit. He was in a militia unit that was being folded into the 2nd Wisconsin. And his uncle would take care of him. And as everybody knew at the time, the war would be over by harvest time. They'd be home by August. So what, you know, what's the big whoop? Well, Henry was 16 and his uncle Archibald was 19. And he was going to watch over Henry. And as it turned out, things didn't pan out the way they planned. The 2nd Wisconsin became the beginning of the Iron Brigade, which was the tip of the spear for the Army of the Potomac out east. And by the time this photo was taken, Henry is 17 years old, 1 year, and he has already been in 6 major engagements in the American Civil War. And he survived through Gettysburg. Well, he got to Gettysburg. I won't say he survived through Gettysburg. It's a good book. If you're a woman and you read the book, you'll cry, guaranteed, at points in it. I think it's safe to say that that'll happen. If you're a guy and you read the book, you're just going to come away with, where's Marcus? Because his best friend's name was Marcus. And that's all I'm going to say about that. So, and I wrote a nonfiction book about a group of guys from southern Minnesota that doesn't mean much because it's southern Minnesota, not Iowa. And with that, I'll get started on my talk. I have one other book I should mention. Because I've written 7 books, and 7 is not a nice symmetrical number, I don't put it up here. Besides, it's so skinny, you can't even write the title on the spine, right? So I'm going to ask Katie. Katie, do you have a shelf of skinny books in the library? Most libraries have a shelf of like super skinny books, you know.
We do not.
No, really? You want to start one? Oh, yes. Okay. Well, this one was everything I learned in 28 years in the Postal Service. Do we have any postal employees here or former postal employees here? Okay. See, no one will admit it. But, you know, that it's not rocket science delivering mail, obviously, because this is the training manual. No. Some of my favorite skinny books that would be along with this one on the shelf, Great French Military Victories. So Great French Military Victories is a skinny book. My other one, second favorite book, is Ethics in Washington. Okay. So this is right there on the shelf with those. One thing I have learned in about 20, 25 years of public speaking is that humor is a great way to start a talk, because it puts everybody at ease. And now I'm no longer anybody special. I'm just another oddball up here talking and getting you to laugh. So that's fine. So we're going to get going on the Iowa home front, what was going on in Iowa, just a taste of it, 75 years ago in World War II. And I say a taste because I could be here until midnight talking about Iowa's contribution to World War II. And y'all have a right to be proud of your state. Okay, you really do. And coming from Minnesota, it's hard for me to admit that. Okay, but I will close the intro with this. Do you know why Iowa does not have a professional football team? Because if you did, Minnesota would want one. Okay. Even Naomi thought that was funny. I score points there. Okay. You didn't think that was funny? Really? Why is this? Oh, and all of a sudden now I'm having a hard time with this. Hang on, let me see if I can start this again and get it. There we go. Okay, picture number one. Here we are. So being a historian, looking at history, you become somewhat of an amateur detective, right? So we're going to take just about 5 minutes and deduce what we can from this photo. This photo was taken during a period of American history, It's obviously in America. I'm not going to tell you what year it was taken. We're going to try and figure that out. Okay? What can you tell me about this photo? What do you see first? What's the first thing?
The flags.
The flags. Okay, what's with the flags? 48 stars. That gives you an important clue, and that clue would be this photo was taken between 1912, when Arizona became a state, and 1959, when Alaska became a state. I almost said Hawaii. That would be bad. Okay, so you've got that period of history. Up until a few years ago, that was the longest flying flag we had. But about 3 years ago, I think it was, we passed that with the 50-star flag. So now we serve under the longest serving flag is the one we fly today. So sometime between 1912 and 1959, these are all young people. They're wearing their finest clothes. The girls are all in dresses. The boys are, for the most part, in long pants, which would be like dress. They have nice shoes on.
They're going to school.
They're going to school, okay. What about their clothing? They have coats on. So it's not July. There's no leaves on the trees. They have hats on, don't they? Yes, they do. And we're going to talk about the hats in a second. But there's no leaves on the trees, which tells me it's not summer. Probably not late spring. Okay. And their hats. Now, this young man is wearing a snap brim hat. Not real common for a young man to wear that during this time period. More common for his father or grandfather to wear a hat like that. This young boy here is wearing a Navy Chief Petty Officer's hat. Certainly not common for a grade schooler to be wearing a chief's hat from the Navy. Now, I know some chiefs have the mentality of grade school. Okay. If you were in the Navy, you'd be laughing with me right now. But, okay. And the look of expectation on this young man's face, he's waiting for something to happen. So I believe it's like a parade, a celebration. And I think with the trees and the clothes and everything else, I would guess it's early November. Okay, there's no snow on the ground yet. This picture was not taken in Minnesota because if it was in early November, they would have 4 feet of snow on the ground. And okay, so it is, I think it's an Armistice Day parade, what we today call Veterans Day. Okay, and it's also during the war years, so we can narrow it down even further because Armistice Day 1941, we weren't at war yet. Armistice Day 1945, we were already out of the war. I believe it's either 42, 43, or 44. My guess would be 1944 because the shoes are impeccable. And early in the war, new shoes were harder to get than the last year of the war because we came out of the Depression. Shoes were something that were not really readily available, especially for young people. They got basically a new pair a year. And by the time 1944 came around, the US manufacturing system was already shifting from guns back to butter. So things like shoes for children were coming on the market late in 44, where they hadn't been in 42 and 43. So my guess would be Armistice Day, 1944. So now you're all qualified as historical detectives, or hysterical detectives, if you prefer. I'm just going to go over these numbers one time. All I'm doing here is showing the impact of the war on the home front, meaning the dollars that were available to be spent on the home front for everyday activities. In 1940, the total budget, everything in the U.S., $20.4 billion, about 6 minutes worth of budget today. Okay. The defense budget was 10% of that at $2.2 billion. 5 years later, at the end of the war, the total budget had increased 6 times, defense spending had increased 42 times. What those numbers tell you basically is if you wanted to buy or build something and it didn't have anything to do with the war effort, good luck. So if you were going to build a new road, it was probably going to go to a defense plant or something, or a power plant. You understand what I'm saying? The infrastructure itself was not even geared towards civilian stuff. It was geared toward the military. The government was trying to win the war in a big way. Okay? And now we're going to go on into other things. At the beginning of World War II, she, because ships are always wonderful ladies, She was on the yards getting ready to be launched and commissioned in New York. She was the USS Iowa, BB-61, first of her class. The Iowa-class battleships had an integral part in the war in the Pacific. They began with 61 being the Iowa and ended with the New Jersey, BB-66. That's how many there were. It included the Missouri, the ship that eventually we accepted Japan's surrender in Tokyo Bay. Interestingly enough, because the Missouri was also the home state of our president at the time, Harry Truman. So if you ever wondered why they chose the Missouri, that's why, because it was his home state. But the Iowa served with distinction during World War II. These 16-inch guns on an Iowa-class battleship could hurtle a shell weighing the same as a Volkswagen Beetle 50 miles accurately. During Korea, they discovered that with the Missouri, that if you fired the guns on the backside of a swell, you could increase that by about 9 more miles. Okay, if you timed the firing right. Now, how accurate? It's kind of like the Norden bomb sight that we used in our B-17 and B-24 bombers could hit a pickle barrel from 25,000 feet, right? My father was a bombardier. One of the first pieces of fake news I was ever made aware of was that you could hit a pickle barrel from 25,000 feet of elevation. You couldn't do that. What you could do is you could put a dumb bomb. There was no guidance on 500-pounders that we were dropping on Berlin. You could put one of those 500-pounders from 5 miles in the air inside the baseball diamond of a baseball field. Okay, that's how accurate that bomb sight was, which is why we went after daylight precision bombing to bomb factories and to bomb armaments and munitions and railroad marshaling yards in Germany rather than the British attempt of bombing whole cities at night. Because quite simply, at night, you don't have a bomb sight that accurate. There was nothing real smart about these weapons. There were chunks of metal filled with explosives that we just dumped by the ton on Germany and destroyed some 85% of German cities over the population of 3,000 during the course of the war. You want an eye-opener, either go online or find a book that shows pictures of German cities in 1946, and you will see absolute destruction, not a building standing in most of them. But another story, the Sullivans, Iowa boys. The five Sullivans serving on the USS Juno were listed as missing in action. The five died when the Juno was sunk in the Battle of Tassafarongo Point. It was one of the naval battles of the Guadalcanal campaign in the summer of 1942. First time we really took the war to the Japanese was at Guadalcanal, landed the Marines, and then left them there with almost nothing to eat for several weeks because the Japanese controlled the waters around Guadalcanal. Our Navy could not take on the Japanese effectively at strength, partly because of the damage they inflicted on us at Pearl Harbor. I've been asked a number of times if I've ever been to the Sullivan Brothers Museum here in Iowa, and I have to admit, no, it's still on my bucket list. I've not been invited to speak in Waterloo either. However, I have been within 1,200 feet of the Sullivans because in 1975, our ship laid a wreath over the sinking site of the USS Juno when I was in the Navy. And so it's sunk in 1,200 feet of water. So I've been within 1,200 feet of the Sullivans. What I think is most interesting, well, two things. One, because of their death, they were allowed to be on one ship. Even today, the Navy has a rule that says brothers do not serve on the same ship. So if you have a brother, you're probably going to be on two different ships. Exceptions can be asked for and made very rarely. The second thing is that the Navy named a ship after these guys. And if you go through the entire roster of ships' names in the United States naval history, 240 plus years of ship names, there's only one ship with the first name, The. So it's easy to find the USS The Sullivans, because that's what the ship was called, okay? What I like most is their mother, Mrs. Sullivan, Ma Sullivan. I'm sure everybody in Iowa grows up watching that movie. You must. It's like everybody in Minnesota, every kid in Minnesota grows up watching The Wizard of Oz because Judy Garland was from Minnesota, okay? So you gotta watch The Sullivans. You gotta watch that movie, you know? And it's a Warner Brothers movie from during the war years, so it's full of propaganda, et cetera. It's a pretty good movie. But Mrs. Sullivan donated a lot of her time helping the USO. This happens to be from the USO site in Des Moines, Iowa. She served coffee a lot. And in doing so, she got to meet some very interesting people. Other people that would come in and help serve coffee. Can anyone identify who this charmer might be? Marlena Dietrich, absolutely. The lady who probably bedded more generals in the American army than anybody since. But only in Europe did that happen. She never went to the Pacific, but she spent a lot of her time doing USO shows in Europe. It's interesting to note that she moved from Austria about the time Hitler took power in Germany. The first thing she did when she got to Hollywood was she became an American citizen, something most Hollywood people like Charlie Chaplin never did. Turned out bad for him later, but a lot of them did not become American citizens. Marlena Dietrich did, and from September 1st, 1939 through September 3rd, 1945, the 4 years that really we were in World War II against Germany, she donated all of her income from Hollywood to the USO. And she was proud to be an American and couldn't do enough to support our boys and ladies in the service. So I really, it's a cool story, but this is one of the times that Marlena Dietrich was in Des Moines. And when she was there, the place would be full. It would guaranteed be full. Glenn Miller. Anybody ever heard of Glenn Miller? Where was he born? Iowa. Where in Iowa? Clarinda, Iowa. There you go. I just learned this just about a month ago, giving this talk. And I'm talking about Glenn Miller's music, and everybody goes, well, he's from Iowa. I went, what? Well, he was, technically. He was born in Iowa, raised everywhere else. Did you know that he, at the top of his game, when he had more gold records, as we call them today, more number one hits, he had more number one hits than the Beatles and the Beach Boys combined. This is the most prolific, successful songwriter in American history, right there. And at the top of his game, he decided to join the military to support the war. So he started an army band. And he would tour Army Air Corps bases. My father, before he was shot down, had the privilege of watching Glenn Miller and the Andrews sisters perform at an air base in England. Embarrassingly enough for my father, he knew the Andrews sisters because they're from Minneapolis, and my mom and dad, when they were dating in high school, used to go watch the Andrews sisters practice before concerts. They practiced at a church in Minneapolis, and it happened that high school kids could go there free. And so they went and got to know them, and at this concert that Glenn Miller and the Andrews sisters were giving at this Air Force base, Patty Andrews would always ask if there were servicemen from Minnesota there, and she would take them out to dinner. Well, my dad didn't stand up, but the rest of his crew pushed him up and said, this guy's from Minneapolis, you know. And Patty looked down at him and went, Dale? I mean, named him, right? My dad felt about this big, but he got to go to dinner with the Andrews sisters that night. But Glenn Miller, in November of 1944, was flying from England to France after the invasion. He was going into the American zone in France to give a concert, and his plane disappeared over the English Channel. No trace, no idea. It happened to about 200 aircraft during the war, where there was absolutely no idea. Yeah, no idea. You know, there was theories, they got shot down, friendly fire, Germans, nobody knows, nobody knows. So, but Glenn Miller, I play his music before every show I do on World War II. Some things happening in Iowa during the war. Any former Navy cooks here? My favorite thing about a Navy cook, besides the food they make, which I enjoyed for 4 years, is that the title of a Navy cook is actually Mess Management Specialist. I don't make this stuff up. I don't. And there's nothing better in the Navy than getting a good mess. because that's called food. And a mess, the mess decks is not what you picture. Mess decks are where you eat, okay? And a mess management specialist is exactly that. They manage, they're specialists at managing food or mess to the Navy. So it's kind of a unique term. I love it. Also going on, glider pilot training. Remember I said that the shift of dollars was going to war production with the taxes and everything? One of the largest refrigerator companies going into World War II, now I know Maytag was down in Newton, where I spoke a couple days ago. I didn't give this talk, I gave a different talk. But the Gibson Refrigerator Company was one of the bigger ones before the war. They were located in Greenville, Michigan. When the war began, the government told Gibson Refrigerator, you're not making refrigerators anymore because we're not selling refrigerators to the public. We want you to make tubular framing for aircraft, for glider aircraft, the Waco glider, because we're gonna take these unpowered planes and drop them and silently insert glider-borne infantry behind enemy lines. And we did. We did it in North Africa, we did it in Sicily, and we did it in Normandy. And then discovered that it probably doesn't work that well. You know, it doesn't work that well. Unpowered planes can't maneuver real well. They discovered at Normandy when they put a brigadier general in one and decided for his safety, he wanted his Jeep, so they put the Jeep in. Well, it could handle a Jeep and it could handle a general. What it couldn't handle was the 1-inch armor decking they put under the Jeep. So when that tow plane dropped its line, that glider went pew, straight down and killed the general, of course. And if you ever watch Band of Brothers, that is in one of those episodes, where they have that glider that came down. So that was going on. They were training glider pilots up in Spencer at Spencer Field. I like this because this is from February 1941. So it's actually like 9 months, 10 months before the war began, right here in, well, over in Tama, okay? Sac and Fox Indians from the reservations near Tama, they were recruits of the 168th Iowa Infantry, which was part of the Red Bulls. That was your Iowa National Guard. We were using Native Americans on walkie-talkies, speaking in their native tongue so that no one knew what they were talking about. Think Navajo code talkers, which didn't happen until 2 years later. So the movies have been made, you know, Wind Talkers is a movie with Nicolas Cage. You know, he's a sergeant guarding one of the Wind Talkers. The Navajo are they're the most famous Wind Talkers, worked with the Marines in the Pacific, but we used Native Americans in Italy and in Europe and in North Africa associated with the 34th Division, just like the Navajo. I met one Navajo Wind Talker once, but I've never met any of the Sac or Fox Indians. But I just think it's cool that you run across the evidence that it was even going on before the war, because you're led to believe it was something we developed during the war. But it had been going on for a couple of years already here in Iowa. Okay. Cedar Falls had a college. And forgive me for not knowing the name of colleges, because name a college today where the students are normal. Okay, anyway, I was going to compare colleges in Iowa are like Perkins in Minnesota. You know, it means that there's a town there, you know. It's like, you have more college, and I love it because it means you're educated as a people, right? I don't think I could name five colleges in Minnesota, really. University of Minnesota. University of Minnesota. No, I already said that one. Anyway, no, there are a number of them. I can slam my home state because Garrison Keillor said Minnesotans have the right to pick on Minnesotans. Okay? Nobody else does. So don't say anything bad about Minnesota. No, I'm kidding. But the dorms in this college in Cedar Falls and most of the school was kind of put on hold for the duration, as the expression was, because we trained Navy yeomen there. Navy waves, they were called. Female sailors, which was like unheard of going into World War II. And their job was clerical for the most part, administrative, and they replaced guys who could then go do what guys were supposed to be doing. And that's like being on ships, being targets, and all that good stuff. It happens that when I was in the Navy, a generation later, half of my time in the Navy, I was a yeoman. So I know exactly what these ladies went through, well, for the most part. But I got to use electric typewriters and computers and stuff. So, my wife and I attend a small church in Ellsworth, Iowa. We go there when we're in season here, like 4 to 6 months over the summer. And about a month ago, I found out that one of the ladies, and I believe Ruth is like 95, 96, she was a student at this school. And she, I found out she had lost her dorm room to some yeoman. Oh my gosh, I sat, and guess who I had cookies with the next day, you know, after church on Sunday. And I picked Ruth's brain about what it was like. And she said, oh, they were the nicest ladies. They would invite us back into our own rooms. And they would treat us with coffee, and because they got extra coffee and we didn't have coffee and all this. It was great. And those are the touches that I really love, the personal stories and stuff. Meanwhile, in Des Moines, a rather unique situation was going on. In World War I, the U.S. Army trained black male infantry officers. Didn't really use them much, and didn't use them at all in World War II. But in World War I, they were training black infantry officers, male types, for the Army. And they decided on Des Moines at Old Camp Dodge, because Des Moines is in the middle of the country and it's not in the racially segregated South. So it was easy to get to by train from either coast, so they could kind of consolidate their training facility for these black infantry officers in one place, and it was at Camp Dodge. World War II, they did the same thing, except it was for the black female officers, meaning nurses, because nurses were commissioned officers in World War II. And so we didn't have black infantry officers, male types, but we had black officers, female types. That was kind of interesting. You know, when you read about that and you're like, I thought we were backwards back then. Isn't that what everybody says, that we're finally getting it today? And I'm like, well, what that we had back then. But anyway, so that was going on at Camp Dodge right over in Des Moines. And I often get Camp Dodge and Fort Dodge confused. And sometimes I wish Grenville Dodge hadn't lived in Iowa, but that's okay. So, but being a yeoman was one of the things that young girls just really wanted to do. They wanted to be a yeoman, or they wanted to be a spar, which would be female Coast Guardsman, or they wanted to be a BAM, which was a female Marine. I always thought that was the best name, BAM. You know, that's what you picture a Marine doing anyway, you know, or a WAC, which would be the Army, female Army. But so that training was going on. Algona, Iowa, up in north central Iowa. Anybody ever been there to the museum at Algona? Okay, it's a nice little museum. I really like it. It was the administrative center for the POWs, meaning German and Italian prisoners of war in the upper Midwest. And we used a lot of these guys. They were captured in North Africa for the most part, later in Sicily, Italy, and into Europe. But most of the ones we had been captured in North Africa in 1942, and when North Africa was finally completely overrun in the spring of 1943, we got shiploads of German and Italian prisoners of war. The Italians, for the most part, were sent to Canada, but a lot of the Germans came to the United States, mainly because we had a lot of Germans here in Iowa and up in Minnesota. A lot of ethnic Germans lived here, including my family. I'm ethnic German. And so we use them in agriculture for the most part, because that's not considered war work by the Geneva Convention. You can't use prisoners of war for war-related work, according to the rules of war, which nobody seems to obey except the United States anyway. Their life was not that bad. They weren't heavily guarded. I mean, they had guards, but they weren't always in their barracks. They weren't always in their camp. They were allowed to go out and work on farms. You can see here, I don't see anybody here with a rifle guarding them. I see two American farmers and a bunch of German farmhands. And they liked the work, because Germany was, for the most part, agricultural, and Austria was, and so is Iowa and Minnesota. We used them in logging, log milling and stuff up in northern Minnesota. Mostly agricultural. They got to live on the farms some nights. Sometimes they were actually allowed to stay overnight on these farms. The farmers were allowed to feed them if they wanted to. The prisoners of war at times were allowed to go to Woolworths If the town nearby had a Woolworths, they could sit at the counter and have a piece of pie and a cup of coffee on their way back to the camp. This is a pretty good life. My father was a POW in Germany. And let me tell you how the American POWs reacted when they found out how we were treating the Germans and Italians. Yeah, our own guys were not real happy about it. One of my favorite stories involves New Ulm, Minnesota, up here. New Ulm had a camp. It had about 30 prisoners assigned to work. Most of them were doing agricultural work, but six of them were former German brewmeisters who had been captured. And it's amazing how you talk to people in Minnesota that were alive back then, how much better Schell's beer got during the war. Augie Schell made use of these half dozen guys, and Schell's beer got to be almost as good as Grain Belt by the end of the war. I think on average, most of them did not want to go back. And they were allowed to go back and apply to come back to the U.S. if they had sponsors, if they had guaranteed jobs, etc. Now, I would compare that with how many American prisoners of war, like my father, were repatriated, brought back to the U.S., and then given the opportunity to return to Germany. I think they may have all been given the opportunity. My father didn't take it up for about 50 years. He went back and visited once. Went back and he was on a bus tour. They were going through northern Austria. My dad was very hard of hearing, like his son. That's why I wear hearing aids. And they were on this bus full of German tourists. And my dad looked out the window and they were passing a it was a Mercedes-Benz plant when he went through in like 1972, whenever it was. And he poked my mom and he goes, "Geez, Gladdy, look, I bombed the crap out of this place back."
Did you say that?
He returned alive. The guys would go to Algona first, and then they were shipped out to different camps. There was one in Owatonna, the town that we lived in for 25 years. They had 12 in Owatonna, 12 of the prisoners. And they had their own little barracks in this one corner of town. And when we moved there, I found out that that's where it was. And I went down. Buildings were gone. You know, you couldn't tell it anymore. Right on the freeway. I mean, literally half of their building is now 35 going up through Owatonna. Not far from where the Cabela's is. It was right there. But they were used on farms around Owatonna. So it was a good way to augment all of the men missing off the farms. You know, it worked. None of them ever escaped, by the way, mainly because it's 1,300 miles to the nearest seaport where you could even conceivably get a ship going over to Europe, you know, and then try and get on it. Right here. Now, this picture is not taken here in Marshalltown, but you had a what? An Army canteen right down on the rails, right down here. You had Army trains, troop trains going through. And just this morning, I read an account, a personal letter from a soldier dated June 7th, 1945. So it was after the war in Europe was over. He had been repatriated. He was one of the early GIs to come back. And he was heading to San Francisco, and he wrote that on June 7th, 45, the train made a stop in Marshalltown, Iowa, and he got a sandwich and a cup of coffee. And so I take that as a historian, that's huge, because it gives me a date, and he names it by Marshalltown, Iowa. And he was on his way across the country and stopped here and got a sandwich and a cup of coffee from ladies like this. This canteen happens to be in a place called Denison, Ohio, which served so many sandwiches and cups of coffee to so many GIs that it became known as Dreamsville. So every now and then you run across an article from the period or a letter, and a soldier will mention Dreamsville, going through Dreamsville. That was Denison, Ohio. A year ago, July, the railroad depot in Denison, Ohio became a National Historic Landmark. It's on its way to becoming a national monument status. And it's a great museum. There were five women, these four, and the one who didn't want the recognition, but she was really the coordinator. The five ladies organized the town of 2,500 people. Now, how many women would live in a town of 2,500? 1,250? How many of them would be adults? Maybe half? So you're looking at 600 or 700 women in this town, right? Take away the ones who already had jobs and stuff. Well, you end up with five who coordinated the effort. They served coffee and sandwiches to almost 2.25 million soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines who went through on the Pennsylvania line, which was a nationalized railroad, only handled troops, didn't handle civilians during the war. And it went right through Denison, and it was a work area very much like Clinton, or like it was a big marshalling yard like here in Marshalltown. And they built some 200 bathrooms when the war began. The Army actually built the privies or the biffies. And so trains would stop, guys would get out, they had 15 minutes to go to the bathroom, pick up a sandwich and a cup of coffee, get back on the train. These ladies would serve this. They knew the train schedules. My question when Diane and I visited the museum, my question was, where'd they get the coffee? Because coffee was a rationed item. Did they get special dispensation of coffee from the federal government? Oh no. They solicited donations of rationed coffee from the entire state of Ohio. They got help from towns 30 miles away because 5 women couldn't serve all those guys. And it was an amazing effort. And all to provide coffee and a sandwich to a boy or a lady going across the country away from home, average age 19 at the time. Soldiers, sailors, airmen, average age 19. Okay, just a little bit younger than today, a little bit younger than the American Revolution. Okay, where it was 20 in the American Revolution, average age in the military today is 21 something. Okay, the other thing I love is that the Red Cross and the Knights of Columbus and all these other groups got together, and before the war, of course, you can see it here, it's before the war. It started in World War I, but it carried on. October is National Donut Month, and so every year that donuts were everywhere for the Army. And you know why October is National Donut Month, right? Because it's an O and it's easy to remember, right? I've never seen a J-shaped donut for January, June, or July, so that's my take on it. That's why they made it October. Victory Gardens. Anybody remember Victory Gardens? Why did we do Victory Gardens? You had them. There you go. It was to raise fresh fruits and vegetables, right? And they would say things like, because we have so many men and women assigned overseas, we have to feed them. And I'm like, but it doesn't matter if they're sitting at the dinner table in Marshalltown or they're sitting at a dinner table in a hooch in the Marshall Islands. It's still the same person. You're not increasing the amount of food needed. Why did we really raise extra food? Okay, the real answer to that, I believe, and historians back me up to it, depending on who you read, right? It's always a matter of opinion. We had to feed other people. And I give you this example. In July of 1943, Italy surrendered 15 minutes before we invaded. When they did that, the Germans, who occupied Italy anyway and outnumbered the Italian army, the Germans confiscated every tractor, every hoe, every rake, every bag of seed. They burned all the crops as they retreated north behind their Gothic line and eventually the Adolf line and others, the Gustav line, as the Americans and the British advanced northward. It was a wasteland. There was no food. So all of these Italian refugees, millions of them, had to be fed. They had no seed for next year's crop. They had no way to plow the ground because of the Germans. So who were we feeding? We were feeding everybody, including ourselves. We were also feeding the British and the Russians through Lend-Lease. And I'll get into a little bit more on Lend-Lease later, but I will mention one thing. Along with Meatless Tuesdays, which were more on the East and West Coast, where they didn't raise a lot of beef and hogs, not so much here in the Midwest, where farms could supply meat for the most part, okay? Meatless Tuesdays were a way of conserving meat. And what it meant in a nutshell was if you were in the military in uniform, you could have a hot dog or a hamburger on Tuesday. If you had a date and she wasn't in uniform, she could have a salad. You could still have a hot dog or a hamburger. Don't give her a bite of it. Oh, no, no. In California, the meat Nazis were watching, okay? And Andy Panda was a cartoon character, little panda bear, real soft and cuddly. In Meatless Tuesday, he basically tells the message to kids. It goes beyond restaurants, kids. If you come home from school on Tuesday and your mom's making meatloaf for dad, you should tell her you're not supposed to eat it because it's Tuesday. You go without meat on Tuesdays. It's a way of conserving meat, okay? So in Iowa, you dramatically increased hog production during the war. You went from an average of something like 7 to 9 animals per farm, hog type, in a farm in the 1930s, to these mega focused on hog production farms where you suddenly had a couple hundred head or several hundred head. Now it's like several thousand head at a time. And they're big corporate structures. Part of that was because of Armour Meats up south of Mankato, and part of it was because of Hormel in Austin. And that's a clue. Don't call it Hormel. They will severely chastise you in Austin, Minnesota if you pronounce it Hormel. It is Hormel, which is why every time I go to Austin, I say Hormel all I can, because, you know. But back to Lend-Lease. I'll ask you a question. Hormel, or Hormel, made Spam. How much Spam did we give Russia, the Soviet Union, during World War II? Give them, because they never paid us back. Lend-Lease was supposed to be paid back later, right? I would love to see President Trump tell Putin, you know, we're not going to charge you interest, but we'd like the original amount back, you know, because we could probably buy a submarine with the amount of money we gave you guys during the war. How much Spam? Just fire out a number, an amount.
10,000
cans, little like 8-ounce cans, a few more than that. How about 1.1 million pounds of Spam went to the Soviet Union? My wife and I have had the privilege of going to Ukraine on mission trips, and when we get there, people asked if we brought Spam with us.
What year was that?
That was from 1942 to 1945. Oh, that I went?
You went to Ukraine.
Oh, when did we go to Ukraine? Oh, I was retired, 13, 12.
Was it after
Russia? Yeah. Oh, yeah, so it would have been like 14 or 15, 2014, 2015. And I went once before that in like 2009 with one of my sons. Same thing. When you go there as an American, they ask, did you bring any Spam or peanut butter? Because they like peanut butter. And you know, Europeans, they eat that Nutella stuff. I'll take peanut butter. Sorry, didn't mean to do that for the camera. But anyway, so Victory Gardens were so important that not only individuals had Victory Gardens, cities had Victory Gardens. This is the prize-winning Victory Garden from Milwaukee, Wisconsin. The federal government put on a contest which city could make the best Victory Garden. And this was first place one of the 3 years that they had this contest. These were public parking areas in downtown Milwaukee that the city plowed up and planted and then, you know, gave the plots to different people in the neighborhoods and stuff. Why would they be able to do that with parking lots?
No gas.
No gas, no cars, no tires, you know, no nothing. I mean, it was pretty rare to see a vehicle on the road. So scrap drives. Everybody was involved, especially young people in scrap drives. This is one of my favorite pictures because it shows a class, and it's not only a scrap drive, but it's what do you want to be when you grow up and help in the war effort if the war doesn't end? So you divide a male and female right through here. All the girls want to be nurses, except the one who wants to be a hospital administrator. The boys want to be, this Boy Scout wants to be a soldier. I think he wants to be either a soldier or maybe an iron worker like his dad. This picture was taken in Pennsylvania, by the way, so we can pick on all of them because they're not from Iowa. This is not an Iowa picture. You know, he wants to be a politician, okay? This young boy, about 7:30 in the morning, told his mom, I forgot I'm supposed to dress up as something today. And his mom said, Rosie the Riveter. So you can see how happy he is. Anyway, but you know, scrap driving was important because we weren't really we probably reused, recycled in rural areas as just a matter of course. You made use of everything on the farm. I know my grandparents did. They were farmers in South Dakota. And I remember that. But you know, I can understand recycling paper and metal, bones. Why would we recycle bones? for the phosphate fertilizers. Okay, so then we saved waste fats, and it says right there for gunpowder, because fats have glycerin in it, right? So you use glycerin for, and of course we recycle defense savings bonds. We recycled our money, gave it to the government, and they reused it. Okay, but scrap going to war, it was huge, it was enormous. And again, there were contests. Minneapolis and St. Paul once had a contest that involved, up there in Minnesota, you would know it's Hennepin County and Ramsey County, or Minneapolis and St. Paul. And they had this big contest. And at the end of it, they had both, all the Boy Scouts and Girl Scout troops and groups in the cities organized these two scrap drives. And nobody could be declared a winner because there was so much scrap, they couldn't really measure it and all this. So I think it was something like the mayor of Minneapolis gave a 50-pound bag of gold medal flour to the mayor of St. Paul, who gave the mayor of Minneapolis a case of Ham's beer or something like that in exchange. I mean, it was beer for flour, you know, good healthy diets up there. Milkweed, let me ask. Anyone who was a kid during the war, do you remember collecting milkweed pods?
Oh yeah, I do.
Do you? Did you ever get paid for them? No. See? Now I go to Ohio, I go to Michigan, I go to Minnesota, the kids got 10 cents for every two bags. Iowa? But in defense of those states, on Friday, they would bring in their two gunny sacks full of milkweed pods, a teacher would hand them a dime, and then the teacher would take the dime back and hand them a war stamp, which they'd put in their little coupon book toward a war bond, okay? So yes, they were getting paid, but the payment was deferred, and all that. But why milkweed? Kids at the, go ahead. Life vests. They actually told you that? Well, at least they told you the truth in Iowa. In Ohio and Michigan, they said, oh, they're for parachutes.
That's what I thought.
See? So some parts of Iowa got told the truth. It was, in fact, because in the spring of 1942, when the Japanese ran over Malaysia, they captured 100% of the world's supply of kapok. Now people, okay, so let me explain this. This is Washington. We think Washington is a little dysfunctional today.
Yeah.
Maybe?
Yeah.
I'm not sensing a lot of disagreement here. Okay. In 1942, they had this war production board. And what they had to do was they assigned priority to different materials. Okay? So someone sent them in a memo and it said, we're out of kapok. And the head of the War Production Board for the US government looked at it and went, what is kapok? Nobody knew. It was like nobody on this board, they had to assign it a high priority, nobody really knew what it was. It's a bark of a tree that floats, it's lighter weight than balsa wood. Okay? So it's used for life jackets. It was used from the Civil War on in America for life jackets in the Navy. Well, what's important about life jackets? What do we need life jackets for anyway? We're fighting the Japanese. We have to go 5,000 miles across an ocean to get to where they came from. We have every intention of going there in thousands of ships with hundreds of thousands of sailors and a couple million Marines fighting on every island. Do we really need life jackets? You think? They made 3 million life jackets out of milkweed fluff because an agronomist at the University of Michigan discovered that 2 pounds of milkweed fluff, not the husks, just the fluff, 2 pounds, which would be each gunny sack, was a pound of fluff. So 2 sacks of milkweed pods would keep a 140-pound man afloat in the ocean for 40 hours. Saved a lot of lives, a lot of lives. And all of these milkweed pods ended up in a place called Petoskey, Michigan, up on the tip of the fist of Michigan, right below the UP. So it wasn't Upers working it, but it was Michiganders working it. That factory, a year ago July, became a National Historic Site because they had produced 3 million. Now this involved 13 American states and 4 Canadian provinces. They collected some, what? 6 million bags of milkweed pods over a period of 3 years. What do you think that did to the monarch population? See? And, you know, of course, you read about the decline in monarchs, and it's blamed on pesticides and everything else that we spray on the fields. I'm not going to call it fake news. I'm going to call it misdirected responsibility. I think the federal government should come in and say, you know, maybe in part it was because we harvested all of the milkweed. These kids were tenacious, right? Yeah. You didn't leave a single pod, baby. This is all or nothing. We're taking it all. And for 3 years, the monarchs had no habitat in their migration, north and south. Had to have an effect. I'm sorry, I'm not into biology or any of that. I'm a historian and a former postmaster. But it had to have an effect to denude their habitat for 3 years. Anyway, so I think the government owes somebody a little bit of a, I'm sorry, we blamed it on pesticides. Okay. That's as political as I get, by the way. I'm pretty tame. This is out of the Des Moines Tribune, 1943, October. This is the rationing chart for that week. If you could understand ration points, you could get elected to public office if you really wanted to, okay? These things, it was a cumbersome system. Everybody got A, B, C stamps, D stamps, and you had certain priorities for gasoline and different things, and you couldn't get sugar anyway, and you know, it was all this, and so it was rife with the black market. In the Midwest, farmers sold meat to family members or friends. I mean, it happened, that's fine. You know, everybody survived. I don't think anybody starved to death in America because they were missing a ration stamp. I really haven't read a single account of that anywhere. But it was a system of trying to control the food. And I think more than controlling the food, what it was making people, again, aware of doing with less. That's what it was all designed to do. It was to make us, as a people, come together and realize we can do without this little bit, and that's helping the war effort. Kids peeling the foil off of cigarette packs and gum wrappers to make airplanes. I'm not sure if all of the foil collected like that in the country in 3 years would have built one airplane. But I do know that rationing in the form of gasoline, which started in May of 1942, 6 months after the war began, on the East Coast, no one understood why we were rationing gas in New York 6 months after the war began. We didn't have a single truck overseas. We didn't even have a single aircraft overseas. What do we need to ration gas for? To keep vehicles off the road. Not because of the gas. America was a net exporter of gas. It was to keep cars off the road because of the rubber tires. Because again, Japan, when they overran Malaysia, captured about 98% of the world's natural rubber supply. And all we had were a half a dozen or so synthetic rubber plants in operation at that time. That's a whole nother story how we got that. I'm not even going to go there, but I'd be happy to talk about it afterwards. But suffice it to say that we needed to conserve rubber for the military. Automobile tires for civilian use. It was so much that the government put Ford and GM to work building military vehicles, in part because civilians weren't going to have new cars because then they'd want new tires. Okay? That's part of it. It's all part of this game plan. It's guns versus butter. One Navy destroyer. And by the way, we built about 270 Navy destroyers during the war. Each Navy destroyer used 50 tons of rubber. One B-17 aircraft, in the course of its lifetime, whether it was 6 months or a year of bombing before it gets shot down or scrapped, each B-17 used about 13 tons of rubber. We made 17,000 B-17 bombers. That's a lot of rubber. That's a lot of rubber. And so your cars, I'm sorry, you're not going to get new tires because we have to build B-17s to bomb Germany. We need to build destroyers to protect our ships against the Japanese in the Pacific. Priorities. That's what rationing was all about. Coffee. Do with less so they'll have enough. He is a happy camper because he's got a big, that holds about 24 ounces of Joe right there. And he's probably about halfway through it because he's twitching from here and he's in a still photograph, you know. I have never yet found the number, the average amount of coffee a GI drank in World War II, but I do know the number from the American Civil War. There's actually a number of how much coffee your average Union soldier drank, and it was about 38 ounces a day of coffee. The difference in the Civil War was coffee kept guys alive, because you had to boil the water to make the coffee. If you drank water, you died of diarrhea. If you boiled the water and drank the coffee, you were alive. Soldiers didn't know that you had to boil water to live. All they knew was that the guys who drank coffee lived longer. So everybody drank coffee by the end of the war because it was keeping them alive. It was the magic elixir. Plus, it was giving them a little kick, you know? So, rationing, we rationed coffee. That was one of the hardest ones for Americans to take, I think, on average, was especially Lutherans. I'm sorry. I was raised a Lutheran. Cigarettes was another one. To me, the most... every bit as bad as coffee. To me, the biggest unfairness in the military was that officers got lucky strikes. Enlisted men got Chesterfields. Now, I never smoked either of those. I was a Marlboro man myself when I smoked. But I sense an unequal or unequal system there. And it got to the point where at the end of the war, when all of the American prisoners of war came out of Germany, there were two camps set up at Le Havre, France, where we would take these guys, the prisoners of war, and we would put on 30 or 40 pounds on each of them before we sent them back home, because we didn't want them to look like they looked like when they came out of the camps. My dad was an officer. He went to Camp Lucky Strike. If you were an enlisted guy, you went to Camp Chesterfield. I mean, that's how they carry, you know, so it went all that way. Anyway, on the home front. This is also a drawing from a Des Moines paper during the period, and this is mom or grandma. I'm in this fight too. She's turning down the thermostat, and she put a sweater on in the winter to save oil for the soldiers, right? Everybody turned down thermostats. You drove slower. National speed limit went down, things like that. I think the largest or biggest social revolution we had in the 20th century, bigger than the Civil Rights Act of 1965, bigger than women's suffragette or giving the women the right to vote in the 20s, was putting women to work during World War II. Women went to work during World War I when Johnny went off to war, with the understanding that when Johnny comes marching home again, you're giving up your job. The women who went to work in World War I knew they were giving up the job when the soldiers came back. World War II, when we started putting women to work in huge numbers in 1942, we didn't know we were going to win the war. So we didn't tell them, when we win the war, you're going to have to give up your job. This was like, you've got this job because you have to help America survive, basically. And women went to work by the droves. And you know what? They liked it. For the most part, they liked it. And in 1944, when we realized we were going to win the war, we had a problem. Because these ladies, a lot of them, didn't want to give up their jobs. And how do you fairly ask them? You know, I met a lady yesterday in Colfax that worked during the war. She made bushings and bombs. And she won an award from the factory she worked at because she could make bushings for these bombs faster than any man that had ever worked at the plant. How do you tell her, well, you know, you gotta give the job back because he's coming back and he's not as efficient, but he deserves the job, right? So one person, for the most part, who has never really received full credit, I don't believe, but deserves it, one person in Washington went to the boss, as FDR was known, and said, I have a suggestion. And it was the Secretary of Labor who said, why don't we, instead of promising the guys their old job back, either get them a better job by sending them to college, we can pay for their college, or we can give them a low or no interest loan to start their own business. So if you were a grease monkey at a service station in the 1930s and you learned that job and you went to war and you came back, how about you own your own gas station? Or we teach you how to be an engineer so you work the oil fields. You know what I'm saying? It improved American society so much. The GI Bill of Rights is what it became known as, the GI Bill. The guys came back from overseas and they were offered free education or they were offered zero or low interest loans to start a small business. Okay? And it bettered America. By the way, who was the Secretary of Labor? Frances Perkins. Thank you. The first female cabinet member of any president in U.S. history. Right on. You know, I'm telling you, it's like, I get goosebumps. You know, I think it's great. And how was she honored? She's on a stamp. You know, which, I mean, in the post office is an honor, right? You get on, I've never been on a stamp. I've had my picture in the lobby of post offices, but I've never. These ladies are working at one of the three largest ammunition plants in America. Three of the biggest plants were in the Midwest, one right here. How many of you have been to Ankeny? It's the town where they build a new freeway on-ramp every other Thursday. Okay? So you've been on 35 too. I can't believe it. I don't even take it. I'm not even going to go through Des Moines anymore. But Ankeny used to be nothing. It was just farm fields, right? Well, then they built this ammunition plant there. And what was it called? It was called Hawkeye Arms. Where they came up with that name, I have no idea. Except that there was one plant in Wisconsin that they called Badger Arms. And the one in Minnesota was called Gopher Arms. Isn't that cool how it works? So one president creates the land-grant colleges back in 1864, 65, and 80 years later, another president names ammunition plants after the mascots of those land-grant colleges. But those three plants made, for example, the Gopher Arms in Minneapolis, which was part run by Remington Arms, that plant made over 90% of the 50 caliber machine gun bullets in World War II. One plant. You have any idea how many 50 caliber machine gun bullets we used? I can tell you that each B-17 bomber, which is only one kind of bomber, 17,000 of them, each one had 11 machine guns. Each machine gun had 27 feet of 50 caliber machine gun bullets. Okay? Why 27 feet? Because by weight, that's how much they could handle for each of those 11 guns. So if you've ever heard the expression, when you're going to kill someone, to give them the whole 9 yards. Isn't that cool? Isn't that fun? The etymology of expressions you never knew about, right? Okay, I have a feeling this picture was taken at Badger Arms in Wisconsin because the ladies are assembling 30 millimeter anti-aircraft shells. Badger Arms did 30 millimeter. Hawkeye Arms did 20 millimeter. Minnesota, for the most part, did 50 caliber. Those were the three most often used next to the 30-06, which the M1 Garand. And I'm not sure where most of those bullets, those were farmed out everywhere. Springfield made them, everybody made them. Clinton, Iowa, not far from here. This is a 3000 series. It happens to be a CNW engine, not a UP. Did anybody see the UP 4000 series the big boy go through? Yeah. This is 3/4 of a big boy. I think it's, but it's, this is such a big machine. It just boggles my mind that how do you even make it work, right? It's just amazing, American American construction. This lady is one I wouldn't tackle in a alley, that's for sure. Here she is too. This is her crew. They replaced men. Men were not drafted out of the rail yards. They could volunteer and be turned down because their job was war critical, but they were also used overseas in the army, in the military railroads. Okay, because we built railroads in France, we built them in Algeria, we built them in Sicily, we built them in Italy, we even built them in the Philippines. Okay, because wherever the army went, railroads followed. It was a way to get material. Ansel Keys was an agronomy and nutrition professor at the University of Minnesota before the war, and he worked with Iowa State and University of Iowa, and was asked to develop a new ration system for the Army before the war began. So we already knew war was coming, and we knew that our old ration system was pretty cumbersome and actually dated back to the Civil War, so it needed to be updated. So he came up with what was called K-Rats. How many of you have ever eaten a K-Rat? Okay, it's like an honor to do that. You know why they're called K-Rats? Because his last name was Keys, started with a K. It's like, when I found that out, I went, I knew who did that, and I never made that I'd like to know who C was, because I ate a lot of C rats, and they weren't very good. But anyway, it was a totally nutritious meal system, easily packaged in nice rectangular boxes so you could pack it up, save space and all this stuff, except of course the round meat cans. The only thing that was missing was chocolate. And the government said chocolate's not necessary. Keyes himself said, you don't need chocolate, there's enough vitamin D already in this, it's nutritionally complete. Well, a guy from Pennsylvania by the last name of Hershey stood up and said, Milton was his first name, and he said, no, you gotta have chocolate in there. And the government said, no, we don't, and we don't have money for chocolate. So Milton Hershey, at his own expense, paid for all of the chocolate supplied to all the troops in World War II. And he said it's because he had a dream, and in his dream, he saw American servicemen and women handing candy bars out to children all around the world. When we win the war that we weren't even in yet. We weren't even in the war yet. So if you go to the Hershey Museum in Hershey, PA, you'll see a D mold and a little information. This is a picture I took a couple years ago at the Hershey Museum. It's samples of the chocolate. And this is a photo taken 2 weeks after the landings at Normandy. It's an American GI handing two little French girls in cute star and stripe dresses. Yeah, how cute. With a sign saying, thanks you, American. And he's handing him a chocolate bar. And how many movies have you seen where an American GI has a chocolate bar and gives it to a kid or something? You know, I mean, there really are a lot of movies made about it. But that involved Iowa. The whole study for this nutrition program involved two universities in Iowa and one in Minnesota. But Ansel Keyes did more than that. He also had this thing called a starvation study, where he took 24 volunteers. They were all conscientious objectors. They weren't cowards, don't confuse that. They were guys who were patriots who didn't want to fight. Two of them became congressmen, three of them became Fortune 500 executives after the war. These were not shirkers. These were guys who just didn't want to fight. But they were willing to go through this starvation study. He took them and in 6 months brought them down to this. 18-inch waists, Barbie would be jealous. They were down to less than right around 600 calories a day while they were carrying a full load of study at the U of M and exercising morning and evening under the supervision of Ansel Keyes. When the first one of these guys was admitted to an emergency room in a clinically starved condition, Keyes said, that's it, first half of the experiment is over, now we're going to learn how to bring them back to full health. And that's what the whole study was about. Keyes himself said, we don't have to learn how to starve people to death. All we have to do is look at Germany and Japan, because they're doing it really well. What we have to do is figure out how we're going to bring people back from a starved situation back to full health. If you just give them food, they will die. So the study ended up in October of 1944. He wrote his paper in November. It went to the Pentagon, new building in Washington, D.C., where it went through different boards. Eventually, the information was broken down, promulgated to commands all around Europe. By February of 1945, most army units in Europe had instructions on how to feed starving people, right at the same time that we were discovering this. Okay? Disturbing photo, I know, I'm sorry. This is actually not a disturbing photo because they have clothes on. Okay? We found hundreds of thousands of this scattered around Europe, France, Belgium, Germany, and America never actually discovered a death camp. I know Dachau was listed as a death camp. I would argue that to the day I die. It was a concentration camp. The death camps were all in Eastern Europe. They were all in Poland and Belarus. The death camps were places where people didn't even walk around like this. People came in and were gassed and were burned and were counted as units. They were not given the opportunity to work. They were just put in the ovens. That's a death camp. A place like Treblinka, which processed almost 1 million. Okay, the 500,000 Jews from Warsaw all died in one camp, Treblinka. Okay, which the Germans then razed, burnt to the ground, buried all trace of it. The Russians found it and didn't even know what they had until someone told them what had been going on there. They didn't even have a clue. You know, when they conquered that area, that's what they found. So is it happenstance that Keyes discovered the, you know, a means of bringing people like this back to full health? Is it happenstance? I don't know. Is it coincidence? I don't think so, personally. My last connection with Iowa during the war years is not this guy, it's her.
Yeah.
It's her, maybe. Okay, over in Boone. So the first lady came from Iowa. I think that's cool. After the war. The general's lady came from Iowa during the war, right? So that is one person's little tiny 1 hour look at the home front in Iowa, a state I didn't even live in until 3 years ago. So thank you, Iowa, for what you did. The 29th state, which yesterday I discovered what 29th state actually means. So thank you so much for taking time. Thanks.